Welcome to FreedomCast, a podcast dedicated to interviewing star icons and entrepreneurs who have encouraged others to become more healthy and active. My name is Ashton, and it's my pleasure to host you as we take another trip through the fitness industry. It's entertaining and informative, and I hope it makes fitness more exciting and special to you in your own fitness journey. FreedomCast is supported by Freedom Fitness Equipment in Charlotte, North Carolina. Freedom Fitness Equipment serves the health and fitness community nationwide, from free weights and strength equipment for home gyms and studios to cardio and conditioning equipment for commercial spaces. Check them out at freedomfitnessequipment.com. Let's get rolling with today's show. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to FreedomCast. We're here with Thomas Allen, who recently got his pro card. And he's an IFBB Pro now. I was talking to the. We're actually sitting in Olympus Gym in where are we now? Huntersville, North Carolina. And it's an awesome, awesome gym. You guys should check it out. But what the owners recommended, I speak with Thomas because he just got his pro card. So, can you give a little bit of background on yourself and how you got into bodybuilding? I know we were talking a little bit about that before we got started. But
yeah, man. So. I originally just got into lifting just from sports in high school, you know, lifting for football and wrestling. It was one of those things where I went off to college and started lifting with some friends, and I honestly just never really stopped. And then what ended up happening is I found this gym over summer in between my freshman and sophomore year of college just to find some place to lift. And the original owner, Matt Cusano, you know, approached me and said, hey man, you know, have you ever thought about bodybuilding? He was a bodybuilding coach at the time. So we just from lifting with him a little bit in the gym, we kind of built up a relationship, and he finally said, you know what, you should do a show, man. My girlfriend's doing a show in 12 weeks. I'll coach you for it, you know, and he did it relatively discounted, you know, for me being a poor college student. And after that, I was hooked. So it kind of started that way, man. And ever since then, I just turned 22. I just got hooked on it, and it's been bodybuilding since.
Yeah. No, that's not what I wanted to ask. But when did you get your pro card? Was it past couple of months?
Yeah, so I got my pro card. It was about 10 weeks ago now.
Okay.
At Junior USA's down in Charleston.
Okay. And how many shows a year as a bodybuilder do you usually do?
Me personally, I would actually do probably less shows than most bodybuilders.
Okay.
Because you can do as many shows as you want. During the season, they usually have a show every other weekend almost. So if you wanted to, you could do back-to-back shows. But especially after my first show, it was an eye-opener. I thought I was a lot bigger than I was.
Yeah.
And once I dieted down and realized what was muscle and what was fat, I knew I had some work to do. So in between my first show and my second show, I took about 2 years just to try to put on more size. And then since then, I've competed about once a year.
Okay.
COVID kind of messed that up, but since then, yeah, it's been about one show a year just so I can make the improvements in between show rather than keep doing show back to back to back.
Yeah.
Plus dieting's not too fun, so I like to go up and wait when I can.
What does it take? So one show a year, how many shows do you have to do in order to get your pro card? Just give people an idea what it takes to get there.
Okay, yeah, so the way it works in the NPC is what it's called. That's the amateur league for the IFBB, is you have to first qualify for a national show, and then the national shows give out pro cards. So to qualify for a national, you have to place, this year they're doing top five, but because of COVID, they're trying to get a little more people qualified, but typically it's you have to place top two in your class at a local show. That qualifies you for nationals. And then depending on the national show, the amount of pro cards they give out is kind of dependent on the size. So for example, Junior USA's top two in each class gets a pro card. But then for other shows, it could be first in each class. So it depends on the show how many they give out, but that's kind of the way you have to go about it, is you have to qualify for nationals and then show up to a national show. And I believe there's about seven each year, and go from there.
So were you placing, for the shows that you were doing, were you placing first or having to place first in order to get your pro card?
Yeah. So to qualify, like I said, you had to get top two. I ended up winning the overall at the qualifier. So there was other people that qualified. The way it works, in case people don't know, is there's different classes. So for classic physique, there's high classes. For bodybuilding, there's weight classes. So everyone that places top two in the class gets qualified. And then the winners of each class go up against each other at the end for what's called the overall. So I was able to pull off the overall at the local qualifier, which qualified me for the junior USAs. And from there, as long as I got top two in my class, I got the pro card. So that's what we're aiming for.
Nice. And from here, once you have your pro card, what kind of shows are you eligible for? Just so people know, like, is there an Arnold? There's like an Arnold Bodybuilding and a couple other big ones.
So it's pretty much any IFBB show. So IFBB is the International Federation of Bodybuilding. They're the ones that run the Arnold, the whole Arnold Sports Festival, which has the Arnold Classic show. The Olympia, obviously, that everyone knows of. The New York Pro is another big one. But there's other smaller shows. Like, there's one in Spain that's a little bit smaller than, the Arnold, for example. So it pretty much qualifies you for any IFBB show that you want to do. Some of them are invite-only. So the Arnold actually is an invite-only show. So you kind of have to be on the higher level of competition to get invited to that. But most of the shows, especially the smaller shows, like there's a Portugal Pro, there's one in Spain. I can't remember off the top of my head the other like smaller ones, but all those you just kind of sign up for and go from there.
Okay, gotcha. From a training and a nutrition perspective, I want to get a little bit deeper on this because I've talked to coaches who've trained IFBB pros. I don't actually think I've spoken with one in person, so this is the first time. So I want to hear from you. Let's talk about training first. So what does it take to if somebody wanted to become a bodybuilder, like what kind of training regimen are you talking about here?
Yeah, so I would say that the biggest thing is actually the consistency of the training. So, you know, a lot of people can come into the gym and, you know, work hard for 1 week, 1 month, 2 months, and then they'll fall off for 2 months and then come back. I would say the biggest thing is honestly the consistency of the training. In terms of actual, like, getting to the nuts and bolts of it, most pro bodybuilders are lifting around 5 times a week, I'd say. A lot of times people ask me if I lift every day because that's what they kind of assume at being a bodybuilder. But one of the things I found and I learned from just watching and emulating other pro bodybuilders is you're growing when you're recovering. So when you're sleeping, when you're eating, and you're resting. So you're only in the gym to break down the muscle for it to get stronger. So if you're in here 6-7 times a week, most of the time, if you're going hard enough, that's not enough time to actually grow and build. So I would say, me personally, I lift about 5 times a week. And from what I've seen most other pro bodybuilders do, some will go as high as 6, and some will go as low as 4. We talked about Dorian Yates a little bit a second ago. He won the Mr. Olympia title multiple times. He lifted 4 times a week. So, he kind of set the standard for, as long as you're going hard and giving the muscle a reason to grow, it's just as important, like you said, with the diet, to get in the food and get in the rest. I'd say 4 to 5 times a week.
And then on the nutrition side, which is like, I feel like that's like 90% of the battle. What are you doing in the off season versus like leading up to the actual show?
Yeah, so honestly, it's almost the exact same foods. The biggest thing is the size of the portions. So for the most part, the protein stays about the same, depending on your body weight. But mostly the fats and carbs just come down as you get closer to a show to put you into a calorie deficit so you can actually, you know, get lean enough to look good on stage. In the off season, they just kind of come up. So for the most part, pretty basic foods, pretty boring foods, chicken, rice, broccoli, you know, potatoes. It's very bro bodybuilder foods. And the biggest thing is just the size difference from off season to actually doing a contest prep.
Leading up to the show, are you cutting and reducing your calorie count like all the way up until the day of, or because I know there's a strategy to that, like you have to look vascular like the day of the show and all that stuff?
Yeah, so the strategy approaching it, my coach actually did my diet, so I'm still coached by the old owner Matt Cusano. So he runs my diet. That way I don't have to think and make emotional decisions, because me personally, I would cut my food way too low because I just want to get lean so quick. The issue is you start to lose muscle mass. So the idea, and what most pro bodybuilders try to do, is keep their food as high as possible while losing fat. Because if you can keep your food as high as possible and the fat's coming off, that's going to keep gym performance high, which is going to keep, you know, your muscle mass retention high. Because a lot of times in a deficit, you're not really gaining too much muscle in the cut into a show. You're just trying to hold what muscle mass you do have and that you built while bringing down the fat. So strategy-wise, sometimes it's just slowly reducing calories all the way into the show. A lot of times there'll be little periods of refeeds, some people will call them, or, you know, maintenance calories, just to bring the body back to a place where it's not adapting metabolically. Because if you keep bringing down your calories lower and lower, your body's smarter than you. It knows what you're trying to do. It'll adapt and your metabolism will slowly slow down. So like I said, my coach does my diet, but in terms of the way we approach it and the way I approach it myself, for I work with a couple amateur bodybuilders, is always food as high as possible for as long as possible, as long as you're making progress.
How many calories are you consuming leading up to the show, like just on a regular basis?
So the exact calorie amount, I don't know right offhand, because everything I do is weighed out in like ounces or grams. So okay. I can give you, like, I can recite my whole diet for you.
Yeah.
I did it once just to kind of see where I was during contest prep. This contest prep, I cut around, it was about 3,200 calories. And it would go down some days. Like I said, the diet fluctuated, so it might be as low as 2,800. I don't think I went much lower than that, to be honest. And then last off season, the highest calorie count I got for a couple months was right around 5,300, I'd say. But that was a lot of food, and that was not fun.
Well, and if you're eating clean, I mean, that's like a lot of like chicken, broccoli, rice.
It coming from a lot of clean food, it definitely was difficult to get in. I mean, it was work every day just to eat the food, which sounds fun, like, especially coming out of a diet you want to eat.
Right.
But you do reach a point where the food literally is just work.
How many weeks are you doing that leading up to competition prep? Is it 4, 8, 12, 16?
So this competition prep to go pro was 18 weeks until I got the qualification. So that first local show was 18 weeks.
Okay.
And then the pro show was 2 weeks, or the pro qualifier was 2 weeks later.
Okay.
So it was 20 weeks dieting total.
Wow.
The shortest prep I've done is 12 weeks, and that honestly just wasn't enough time.
Yeah.
We had to push calories too, like I said, pushing calories too low too quick, you lose muscle mass. And so because I only gave it 12 weeks to get in shape, we had to go pretty low calorie, and I definitely lost some size in the process, which kind of defeats the purpose of bodybuilding when you want to be as big as possible. But I would say on average, usually 16 weeks is an average prep. One thing I will say is the longer you give it, sometimes the better, even though it's a little more miserable, just because if you run into any speed bumps, you know, if you set an end date, it's nice to have that end date to put fire under your ass. But if you're not ready and you only gave yourself 14 weeks, it would be better off if had you given yourself 20 weeks with 2 weeks to spare and you're ready early, if that makes sense.
So like if you fall off the bandwagon from a nutrition perspective, or something's not going right in training.
Yeah, or even if it's something like out of your control, like your body just fights back metabolically. Like I said, if your metabolism slows down and you start to have to play games of giving periodic refeeds and you can't push the calories as low, always having a little bit more time rather than, oh crap, we're 2 weeks away and we look like we're 6 weeks away. That's never a good place to be.
Yeah, because the timing of that is like insanely important. That's half a year of prep almost. Like 20 weeks is an insanely long amount of time. And then on contest day, talk a little bit about like what are you doing? Are you? And also by that point, I've heard some bodybuilders are like, they're waking up like every 4 hours because they just can't sleep because they're so lean. I mean, what percentage body fat are you? And then during day of contest prep, like what kinds of things are you doing leading up to being on stage?
Yeah, so in terms of the actual show day, one thing I will say is I love bodybuilding and I love the process of it. Show day is the worst day for me. And not in terms of stress. I just don't actually like the act of shaving, tanning, competing. I'm not very much of a showman, to be honest with you. My posing isn't great. Some of those guys get up there and they, you know, they can dance and they can like look just absolutely aesthetic in poses. I've had to kind of learn to fake it. So the actual competing part of it, I'm not, you know, the hugest fan of, but it's the end result. In terms of body fat percentage, it's hard to say. I would say, you know, because there's tons of different ways to measure. I've measured various ways, but I would say on average, most of those guys who are doing well on the national level, you're floating around 4%. And yeah, sometimes it is hard to sleep. It gets, sometimes it's nerves. Sometimes it's just, you're so hungry, you're waking up. That's one of the other benefits of, you know, if you can keep the food high, you sleep better, which means you're recovering better. So luckily this last prep, the 12-week prep, I was terrible with sleep just because I was so hungry. Like you said, I was waking up. This last prep, it actually wasn't too bad. Show day, I was pretty relaxed because we were able to eat so much food into the show. I wasn't waking up too hungry. And, you know, all that's kind of snowball's effect, because if you can eat as much food as possible, then you're not waking up in the middle of the night, which means you're recovering more, which means you're either building or maintaining more muscle. So it kind of just like snowballs through. If you're doing everything correct, it just helps the whole process.
I've heard for some guys who have a gigantic amount of muscle, and you're huge, is like sleeping at night, they need like a CPAP machine or something like that to help with that. Are you to that point yet, or are you like, I see that in the future?
I definitely need one, because my fiance is going to kill me if I keep snoring. And I definitely wake up sometimes, like, you've seen like the little French bulldogs that like snore themselves awake. I will snore myself awake, which I'm pretty sure is technically part of sleep apnea. More so when I'm heavier in the off season. So luckily right now I'm still relatively light compared to how heavy I've gotten in the off season. The biggest thing actually for me is not rolling over on my side, because my arms will go numb if I roll one way or the other. So fortunately right now I don't need a CPAP or anything.
Yeah, yeah.
I definitely did need one last off season, and I just never got around to doing a sleep study or anything. But you know, like we were talking about, sleep is so important that if that's something you need, especially being a heavier guy, even if you're not fat, just that physical weight, a lot of the guys I do know need CPAPs. It's probably something that I've just been holding off on. But here soon, I'll probably need one.
So I've never really asked about this, but posing and muscle groups and all of that kind of stuff, like, how do you know if you're... Do you have to have like this insane knowledge of anatomy in order to figure out like where you might be deficient in certain muscle groups, and then you need to go and train those? Or is it more, I'm looking at myself in the mirror, I kind of see from a judging perspective, this is where I might need to work on something? Like how does that go?
So it's a little bit of both. I would say where the anatomy helps the most is actually understanding whether you're doing a movement right. But in terms of initially picking out what you need, a lot of times, that's why it's helpful to have a second eye, because I might think something looks incredible and it absolutely doesn't. So, A, being honest with yourself, if you can look in the mirror and then look at who's winning shows and kind of pick apart what you're missing, the judges will actually give you feedback. So even if you just do a local show, you email the judges and send them your stage shots, they'll get back to you with what they think, you know, you're missing. And obviously with them being the deciders of whether you win or lose, you should probably listen to what you need based off of them. And then, like I said, with my coach, he also is helping, you know, pick apart what we're missing, what we need. And then that doesn't take too much knowledge of anatomy. I would say having a little bit of knowledge in that helps figure out how to train those weak muscles. Because a lot of times, if you do have a weak muscle, it's probably because you're doing a movement wrong, incorrect, or just your body structure is set up where that muscle isn't optimally moving the weight. So for example, some people are chest dominant benchers, or some people are shoulder dominant benchers. A lot of times that's not because they're doing the movement wrong, it's just the way their anatomy is set up, or their bones are set up. So then picking movements based off of, you know, anatomy and kinesiology of how the body moves, you might need to do a different variation of bench press to hit your chest than someone who just naturally grows their chest. So that knowledge helps a little bit. And then sometimes there's the guys that are just lucky who grow even, and you don't have to have knowledge of anything. You just come in and lift. I don't think that's most people. Everyone has a weak body part, but yeah.
What is the judging criteria then? Is it completely subjective based on the judge's eye, or do they actually have, I don't know, I think, like, do they have, this needs to be this size, this needs to be that size, or is it all relative to other competitors?
So I would say the way they kind of judge it is they've set the standard based off the pros. So if you look at who won the classic Olympia, I'm not sure if you know him, Chris Bumstead. They kind of take like the top five guys in classic, and the judges are deciding, here's the look we want for a classic physique. So they're basing the criteria based off those top guys. So it kind of gives you an idea of what they were looking for. Same thing with the bodybuilding class. You know, it's kind of whoever won the Olympia is the standard. And there's certain proportions they always look for. It's one of those things where you just want to have the most ridiculous proportions you can. So as wide shoulders as possible, to as narrow waist, to as wide legs. But in terms of, you know, actually having like a standard written down, they do have some rules and regulations on the site, on like the actual NPC site, of what they're looking for. But because it is such a subjective sport, they kind of do have to have those pros like Chris Bumstead, Terrence Ruffin, as a standard to look down on the amateur league, the NPC, and decide what they're looking for.
Okay. So you're looking at like the Olympia and saying, this guy looks this way, I need to get it to that point, basically?
Yeah, pretty much.
Wow. That's a high bar. That's insane. Yeah, I always wondered about that, and I'm sure from I love fitness equipment, so from a fitness equipment perspective, it really helps having like a commercial gym, because then you can hit every single body part you could ever possibly think of to like get that kind of physique. Do you think you can be an effective bodybuilder if you just had your own home gym and a squat rack, or do you need certain types of equipment to like really isolate certain things?
Yeah, so this is something, you know, I've really thought about for a long time, in terms of like, can you do it bare bones, or can you do it, or do you need certain equipment? I would actually say that comes down to a lot of genetics, because some people just grow evenly. A great example is squats. So some people grow massive quads from squats, depending on the way their actual anatomy set up of their like their iliums, the way their acetabulum inserts, you know, how much knee flexion they have, their ankle mobility, all, you know, help decide whether that squat's going to be a quad dominant squat, or whether they're going to use like their low back. Like you've seen, it's technically right form, but a lot of powerlifters will still have more of a lean forward, and it's more low back dominant, it's more erector dominant, adductor dominant. So in terms of bodybuilding, you might not grow from that. And if you can't physically get into the movement of an upright squat, which some people can't based off their anatomy, then you wouldn't be able to grow optimal quads, bare bones. So whether or not you could do it with minimal equipment, I would say would really come down to whether you're someone just naturally grows evenly. And some people do. I hate to say you need certain machines, but I would say most people who have a lagging body part, it definitely helps having machines. I don't think I know of any bodybuilders that don't use machines, or at least cables, up until a certain point. So I don't know any of them that are just using squat rack, a barbell, and dumbbells. And it's mostly for picking what's lagging. I would say most of them are using barbells, dumbbells, for the base of what they're trying to achieve. So, you know, do your barbell rows, and then look at your back. What's missing? Rear delts is missing. Okay, I'm gonna hop on a rear pec deck machine to compensate for what I'm missing in the movement.
Compare bodybuilding to say powerlifting, generic weightlifting, Olympic lifting. Do you think there's more of a psychological game? It's more of a physical game. Do you think? I've heard people say bodybuilding is like, as far as from a psychological standpoint, it's probably the toughest sport to be in. But how does that compare to some of those other disciplines?
I would say, honestly, the biggest thing is outside of the gym. So unlike, you know, powerlifting, Olympic lifting, you can be a little bit more lax with your diet as long as you're making sure you're recovering. You know, in terms of getting optimal sleep, yes, obviously having the best sleep for sports performance, no matter what you're doing, is going to be the way to go. But in terms of bodybuilding, it really is so much outside of the gym of making sure the diet's just dialed in, the sleep's dialed in, the recovery's dialed in. So I would say the consistency is higher. I wouldn't necessarily call it harder, because I've wrestled in high school, and I'll say this. Those practices were harder than bodybuilding, but they were acute. So it was only, you know, 2-hour practice, and then the rest of the day I can go home and play video games, and I'm not, like, starving myself. Or same thing, like, the weight cuts for that are only, like, a week of cutting water weight, you know, which sucks, but it's not 20 weeks. So I would say bodybuilding's more like death by 1,000 paper cuts rather than, you know, an intense, like, workout or an intense practice. So it's one of those things of how much can you stand for how long? Because it's more just constant you're just constantly uncomfortable, especially when you're hungry. It's just your mind will be thinking about something, and then it's food. And then you try to get back on track, and every 30 seconds you're thinking about, is it time to eat? It's like, oh, it's only been 5 minutes. And then you check the clock again. So you're just almost constantly uncomfortable, I would say. So it's, like I said, death by 1,000 paper cuts.
Yeah.
Which some people can handle just fine. Some people I've seen handle bodybuilding great, and then others, it's just such a cycle. And I think at some point, being that lean is always psychologically difficult. But some people, it's psychologically difficult from week one all the way to week 20. And then some people, it's only the last 4 weeks.
So then how do you manage that? Did you just have a strong mentality coming into this, or are there things that you're doing to kind of distract yourself or whatever it is leading up to competition or just training in general?
I would say I handle it decently well in terms of the psychological side. I will say I'm definitely one of those people where the first 12 weeks is easy, and it's like the last 8 feels longer. Like the last 3 weeks feels as long as the first 17, to be honest. And maybe that's just because the show's closer and it's just something that's always on my mind. Psychologically with food, I don't really have much of a problem. A lot of that was just cutting weight for wrestling. I did that since middle school, so I've always cut weight to a certain extent every single year for some reason or another. So I never really had a problem with that. I would say for me it's more just the anxiety of the show getting closer. And especially even when things are going absolutely perfect, it's just waiting for that second shoe to drop of like, am I going to come into the gym today and get injured? Or you know, just being scared of that. I don't know where he came from. Yeah, but psychologically, you know, everyone has their battles. I would say mine is more just being anxious about the show rather than is fighting cravings or anything like that. Just because when you are getting that lean, even if you are good at the diet, your body just starts playing tricks on you. You know, you're looking at yourself in the mirror and you're not seeing what everyone else sees. It's, oh my God, I'm not going to be ready in 4 weeks. And then two minutes later, you'll be thinking, oh my God, I'm not big enough. And then you're thinking another 2 minutes later, okay, I'm not going to be lean enough. And you just keep going back and forth of, oh, I need more food because I need to gain more size, or, oh, I need less food. And it's like, you just got to trust, if you have like a coach, just trust the coach, trust the process, and continue to keep going.
How important is it having a third party evaluating you, like having that coach? Like, do you think it would have been as successful if you were doing this yourself, had you done your own research, all that kind of stuff?
Man, I think most bodybuilders would agree with me on this. A coach is just so much more helpful than trying to do it on your own. I don't know any pros that do it on their own. Now, a lot of them are knowledgeable enough that I think they're kind of doing a back and forth repertoire with your coach of spitballing ideas. But having that, you know, that third party opinion to keep you sane and keep an unbiased, hey, you're not going to be ready, or no, you're doing great, calm down, you're completely fine. Because even if you know what to do, as soon as you're looking at your own physique, there is an emotional investment, because we all have emotional investments in how we look. You know, even if we don't want to admit it, oh, we don't, like, people can say, oh, I don't care what people think of me. Everyone does. Yeah, exactly. And especially when it comes down to, like, how you look, you know, when you're up there in nothing but, you know, your posing trunks, there's so much emotional investment in your own physique that having someone else look at you, even if you can coach other people perfectly, having someone else look at you and be honest with you is huge. Like I said, I don't know any pro bodybuilders that don't have a coach that's helping them out, just to give them that opinion.
On the competition, I didn't ask this, but I know there's a couple different divisions within bodybuilding, right? Like there, you mentioned classic, and what are the other ones, and how do they differ?
Yeah, so there's three divisions for men. There's men's physique, which is just board shorts. So it's more, they're really just looking for abs and huge V tapers. So super wide shoulders, very much a beach look. That's why they're wearing board shorts. So legs are completely covered. Then classic physique is Chris Bumstead. So they're looking for just aesthetic structure, but still just that old school bodybuilding look. Yeah. So kind of what happened when they introduced that is they looked at bodybuilding and it had just become such a mass show of how big can we get. It was no longer aesthetic. No one wanted to look like the pro bodybuilders. So, and then men's physique was also a little too small in terms of, you know, it's just, you know, more of an abs competition, a beach look competition. So they brought in the classic physique to kind of fill the gap of, we want to go back to that more like Arnold Schwarzenegger look, that old school Steve Reeves type look. So still keeping a lot of mass. Like, by no means is Chris Bumstead small. You know, 240 pounds shredded is not a small person. But at the same time, keeping that tight waist, having it something where, you know, teenagers look at it or people look in the magazine and go, I want to look like that guy, compared to seeing somebody who's just freaky like Phil Heath and just being disgusted by it. Now, I find that awesome. Yeah. I find that cool. And honestly, the goal for me will always try to be to get there, yep. Even though I am currently a classic competitor. But, you know, just to bridge the gap and make it a little bit more mainstream, that's where they brought in classic. And then, obviously, bodybuilding is just as big as possible, yep. As lean as possible. And they still do to keep into account proportions. They don't want blown out waist. That was something the pros were getting kind of hounded on for a while, was their waist were getting a little too protruded. The guts almost. Yeah. So, I mean, they have abs, but they look like Ninja Turtles.
Right.
The guts are sticking out. So they still do want that tight waist. They do want like wide shoulders to waist to wide quads and have proportion. But at the end of the day, it's a mass game for those guys. So it's just as big as you can possibly get. And then having those proportions just gives you the illusion of being bigger, because you could either grow your shoulders bigger or you could tighten your waist and it makes your shoulders look bigger.
So was that what Ronnie Coleman was competing in? Was like just pure bodybuilding? Like,
yeah, Ronnie Coleman, Dorian Yates, okay. Phil Heath. And even in Arnold's day, that's all there was just bodybuilding.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so then, like, you're talking about like that gut but still having muscle. Is that from water retention or what is that?
So there's a lot of theories behind why. Some people will call it growth hormone gut. Some people call it insulin gut. And then some people just say it's from food. I think those are the three most popular theories. So a lot of it, people will say these guys use tons of growth hormone, and growth hormone just doesn't grow muscle. It can grow organs as well. So one of the theories is that these guys have grown out their organs. Another one is that insulin can cause like fatty liver disease, and also grow your organs as well, because insulin does have an effect on organ growth. So that's possibly the issue. But honestly, when I've looked at these guys, because a lot of them now, since they've been hounded on their guts, have reversed it. A great example is if you look at Ben Pekulski, who was a famous bodybuilder in the 2000s, he got hounded on his gut, and then he was the first guy to just absolutely come back with the tightest waist. So obviously he couldn't shrink his organs if they'd grown. A lot of it, I think, is food. So what these guys are doing now is they're being smarter about their food choices and figuring out what digests well. And one thing too is before a show, a lot of these guys are what's carbing up, because they've been dieting for so long, the muscles are depleted. So to give them a full popping look, you know, having veins and everything, they're carbing up. Well, when those guys are that big and have that much muscle, they have to eat so much food to carb up. Sometimes they play that game of risking having that food not digest, and then they're on stage and that food's sitting there and protruding. I think it might be a combination of all three. I couldn't tell you for sure. I know me personally, I'm actually kind of wide-waisted, and that's just genetics. And I think pushing the food hasn't helped. But making smarter food decisions, especially into a show, definitely helps bring down the waist. And I think a lot of those guys are being smarter about it now. There's not as many waists or wide waist as there were, you know, 5 years ago. So I don't think it's completely organ growth, just because a lot of the guys have reversed it now.
Yeah, that would make sense. If it was your organs, you would definitely still be able to see that. Is there anything that people would be surprised to know about bodybuilding?
I would say how little of it is in the gym. I think they would be surprised by the consistency of food and the like accuracy that it takes to have everything weighed out constantly. Like a lot of times when I talk to people just in the gym, you know, they obviously know I'm a bodybuilder and they ask me about it.
Yeah.
They just kind of assume I'm just eating chicken and broccoli and like not really weighing anything out, but just, you know, just eat your protein and that's fine. That most of the work's done in the gym, and then as long as you're eating protein and veggies and healthy food, you just get ripped and in shape. When really so much of it is a game of having all your calories, all your macronutrients, and all your food just weighed out to the gram every single meal, day after day, week after week, month after month. So I would say the consistency of it would probably surprise most people. And honestly, how boring it is. Because a lot of times, you know, like we were talking about earlier, you're grown when you sleep. So you're making the decision of, oh, there's an hour left on this Netflix movie. I'm going to shut that off and go sleep to make sure I grow and that I recover, rather than, oh, I can finish this hour. So a lot of it's just being kind of boring and in your bubble, to be honest.
How important is the meal prep aspect, and how many meals a day are you usually eating for what you're doing?
Yeah, I mean, the meals is pretty much it. I think, so Evan Sinopani, I'm not sure if you know who that is. He's a famous bodybuilder. He said it best. He's like, I'm a professional bodybuilder, so basically I'm a professional eater. And so that's pretty much, 75% of the battle right there is getting in the food. Most guys are eating around 5 times a day minimum, and then up to 7. Now, there's a lot of back and forth, especially among just like gym goers, of whether it's more optimal to eat more often. Some people say no, some people say yes. In terms of bodybuilding, disregarding whether it's more optimal to eat 6-7 times a day, to physically get in the food we have to eat, you have to space it out. So even if it wasn't, you know, because there's studies of, oh, if you bolus protein, it's not as effective as small feedings throughout the day. Disregarding that entirely, just to get in the amount of food, I have to eat 6 times a day or else it won't digest. So I personally eat 6 times a day. And then in the off season, sometimes it's 6 times a day with a shake added.
And what is that doing? So could somebody be successful and eat 3 square meals a day or whatever, or aside from whether or not it's physically possible and you want to throw up afterward, but like is that realistic?
I would say depending on your division. So for a men's physique guy who doesn't need too much muscle, I could say he could probably get away with that. In terms of actually trying to be like a pro bodybuilder fighting to place high on stage, and even for the most classic guys, I would say no. You probably would have to eat at least 5 times a day. Now, could you if you just bolused it all 3 times a day? I would say that would probably start to interrupt just like your effectiveness in the gym. Because if you're coming to the gym and you're bloated and you're trying to lift, you know, all that blood's in your stomach, it's not into the muscles, you feel like you're going to puke while you're working out, you're going to affect workout performance. So if you were eating less food, you know, like I said, and you didn't need too much size, then maybe you could get away with 3 times a day. But for the most part, there's a reason 95% of the guys are eating 6-7 times a day.
Yeah. And so you touched on a little bit like what that is actually doing from a practical standpoint. So it's helping you not feel bloated during a workout. What is it doing from a physique standpoint then, like eating 5 or 6 or 7 times?
Yeah, so, I mean, there's a lot of studies behind this, but, you know, bolusing protein isn't as effective as having small meals throughout the day because your body can absorb it better.
Got it. Okay.
So having small meals of protein, your body can only upregulate protein synthesis so much, which is building muscle.
Right.
So having, you know, those smaller meals helps. In terms of same thing with carbohydrate absorption, so if you have all your carbs bolused in one meal, or even if you split into three meals, if you're eating a ton of food,
yeah,
that's a lot for your body to digest, and that's going to shoot your blood sugar through the roof, and your body might have to overproduce insulin to kind of bring that blood sugar down, shuttle all the nutrients, and that's never a good thing, you know, in terms of physique development, having higher blood sugars and higher insulin. So in terms of what it's actually doing, there's just so much science behind gym performance improves when you have smaller meals throughout the day, because it's actually not sitting in your gut. It's gone through the GI, it's in the bloodstream and gone to the muscles to actually fuel the workout. The amino acids are there to rebuild after the workout, you know, and those fats are there as well to improve recovery. So having the smaller meals definitely goes a long way.
From a protein standpoint, there is so much back and forth in the fitness industry about like how many grams per pound you need and all that kind of stuff. What have you found to be most effective? I'm not even just talking about bodybuilding, just from a lifting standpoint. Do you need like a crap ton to be effective in the gym, or, you know, is the, I don't know, about a gram per pound more or less okay?
Yeah, so one thing I would say on this, and it's something I kind of learned from bodybuilding, because before when I was just lifting casually, I did follow more of a macros approach, which was just get in your protein. It doesn't matter whether it's coming from a Quest bar or whether it's coming from Fairlife milk or whether it's coming from chicken breast or Halo Top ice cream. You know, as long as it's protein, it's protein. So I would say I'm pretty on board with the anywhere between 1 gram per pound of body weight to 2 grams is pretty standard. How much you need personally, I do think it's a little bit genetically dependent, but the way I would judge that is start middle ground, 1.5. And then if that's hard for you to eat, go down. And if you're still seeing performance, you're still seeing, you know, muscle gain, then maybe you didn't need 1.5. Maybe you could get away with 1.25. But if you see that that recovery go down, you're more sore, you're not building as much muscle, then you definitely were better off at 1.5. So maybe you'd be better off above. So I'd say set a baseline. And then from there, titrate up or down. But where I was going with in terms of the macros was, the other thing to take into account too is not all protein is equal. So macros kind of implies as long as you get in 200 grams, if you're a 200 pound man, that's all that matters. Well, that's not accounting for the EAA content, or the amino acid profile is what it's called of protein. So for example, there's 9 essential amino acids your body can't produce that you have to ingest. No one plant-based source has all 9. So if you're getting your protein from plant-based sources, you're not getting a high amino acid profile, and it's the amino acids that build muscle. So if you get, you know, let's say a 30 of your protein from a low quality source that doesn't have a ton of essential amino acids like Halo Top and then maybe like a Quest bar, you know, and that's a third your protein, and another third is coming from like plant-based sources, and then the last third's coming from meat sources, I would say the person who's getting the same 200 grams of protein a day coming from all high quality sources like meat, whole eggs, high quality whey protein isolates, that type of thing, it's going to have a better essential amino acid profile and better recovery. Now, how important is that for like the average gym goer? Probably not. You're like, in terms of bang for the buck, in terms of convenience, I would say just track your protein. In terms of bodybuilding, those tiny things add up. So I would say for bodybuilding, yes, it's extremely important. But for the average person, like just trying to see results, you know, they're not going to be absolutely psychotic about tracking everything. And even tracking macros is hard enough. So just tracking your protein is far enough, I would say, to see results.
You talking through this just makes me realize like the level of detail you guys are going through on the nutrition side is 10 times more complicated than I think people realize. Even down to, I was talking to somebody else about this, the digestive time it takes, like brown rice versus white rice, for example, like, are you timing stuff like that as well?
To a certain extent, a lot of times I take those into account, but just because something looks good theoretically on paper doesn't mean it necessarily applies. So
okay,
for example, if on paper it makes the perfect sense for me to eat something medium digesting in terms of timing, like oatmeal pre-workout, that way it's fueling the whole workout, but at the same time, you know, I'm not having something too quick digesting. Well, if I don't digest oats well personally, and I'm burping it up throughout the workout,
got it.
On paper it might be the best thing. But if it's, like I said, if it's still in my gut and it's not in the bloodstream, that glucose hasn't gone to the bloodstream, to my muscles to fuel the workout, then on paper, it makes sense. But I'm just, you know, kind of brute forcing it compared to if I pick something like, you know, a jasmine rice, even though that might be higher glycemic, you know, if it digests well for me and it fuels the workout, then it makes sense. One thing I think people don't take into account too with that is everything in terms of the glycemic index of sweet potatoes versus white rice versus brown rice was all developed when they took patients fasting, gave them that food, and saw how quick their blood sugar rose or didn't rise, but they were only eating that food. As soon as you add fats to a meal, that slows down digestion. As soon as you eat protein with a meal, it slows down digestion. So, you know, someone might have a higher glucose spike from just eating a sweet potato on its own compared to, I might actually have a lower glucose spike eating white rice with chicken because the chicken slows down the absorption. So there's a lot of subtleties that come into play that, you know, you can look at it on paper, like sweet potato might make the most sense. But like I said, if it's not digesting, then it kind of defeats the purpose.
Your level of knowledge on this is far beyond, obviously, anybody I've ever talked to on that. How did you learn about all of the, like, did you have a nutrition and science? I can't remember what you said your major was when you graduated, but like, you just learned this over time, look on the internet.
Yeah, so in terms of like my actual credentials, they're very few. Okay. The only thing I have in terms of like the anatomy side is I'm a licensed neuromuscular massage therapist. Yeah. So I went to school for that. So I do have that background. In terms of the nutrition, a lot of it was trial and error. Okay. What I did is I kind of did it, learned the hard way. So I did the macros, and then I saw results, but then I wanted to see more results. So then I went with like the meal plan when I did the bodybuilding show for the first time, and I saw better results. And I was like, okay, maybe there's something else behind here besides just macros. And then I learned about the digestion when I was kind of brute forcing it myself. One thing I used to do is, you know, I knew food choices mattered at that point, but I was still like, oats make the most sense on paper. So I would eat like 100 grams of carbs from oats with, and I was like, egg whites are easy on my stomach. So I would eat like 20 egg whites before I lifted, like cooked into the oats, and it sat like a brick. I wanted to puke every workout. But I was hard-headed and did that for like 2 months. And then finally, when I was like, you know what, let me switch to chicken and rice because I just can't do this anymore, and it digested better, I saw better results. So a lot of it was, you know, a little bit of research, a little bit of learning myself. And a lot of it, man, is just trying to emulate what pro bodybuilders do. Because a lot of times they get a bad rap for bro science. But if you look at what 95% of them are doing, there's a reason they're doing it, you know. And that's something I kind of had to learn the hard way, is there's a reason most of them are sticking to chicken and rice. I just thought it was them being bros, but there really is a purpose behind it.
Yeah, it's the level, well, and it makes sense, like the level of detail you have to go to. I mean, you do have to, I don't know, there does have to be some bro science behind it, because it sounds like to me like there is, because of the genetic component, it can be more of a feel thing sometimes for people. So that makes sense. What's your favorite body part to train?
Oh man, my knees aren't hurting legs, to be honest, but honestly it depends on what's hurting.
Yep, I got you.
Whichever body part doesn't hurt that week.
I got you. Cool.
Man, I on that same note, from a cardio standpoint, I know you're lifting quite a bit during the week, but how important is cardio, and what kind of cardio are you doing?
Yeah, so in prep, it's mostly low intensity steady state. Mm-hmm. I've never really done HIIT into a show. Now, some people do. From a bodybuilding standpoint, it makes the most sense to do low intensity steady state, only because to a certain extent during a prep, you're really stressing out the body. So you're lifting hard 5 times a week,
yeah,
and your body's trying to recover from that. And you're having, you know, a calorie deficit for 20 weeks, you know, maybe even longer if you're doing multiple shows. So the body's trying really hard to recover. So any more demand on recovery that's unnecessary can sometimes hold you back. So I found HIIT a lot of times is kind of like a last resort if you need it. A lot of times it's just stair mill or treadmill, slow intensity, steady state.
Okay, just taking walks, things like that.
Yeah, things like that. And really, you know, bringing in the fat loss from the diet and then using the cardio to help facilitate it.
Yeah, because I always just, I don't know why I thought this, but I always assume, like if you're trying to cut, everybody does cardio. But when you're trying to cut, you're lifting a little bit more, I'm assuming, and just focusing on the nutrition part. You're not changing so much that you're going like you're doing CrossFit style workouts or anything like that. It's super cardio heavy.
Yeah, no, the workouts actually don't change at all. If anything, the volume sometimes gets slightly reduced near the end. Because, yeah, a lot of times, and I've made this mistake myself, is as I got closer to a show, it's like, oh, the show's coming, got to work harder. Drops that superset. The issue is it's a game of recovery at the end of the day, because you're not building muscle, especially 4 weeks out from a show. When you're going from like 5% to 3% body fat, you're not going to be putting on muscle, so you're just trying to maintain what you have. So any more recovery that your body can't come back from is just going to be loss of muscle. So, you know, if you're doing 5-6 sets, when you're used to doing 4 sets, 3 sets, you know, that's going to be recovery that your body's not going to come back from, and just, you know, muscle you're going to lose. So a lot of times, and I've heard multiple pro bodybuilders say this, so it's something I've kind of emulated, is whatever built the muscle is going to keep the muscle. So if you did, you know, 2 sets on bench to build it, stick with those 2 sets.
Makes sense.
Another fitness equipment question. What's your favorite piece of fitness equipment to train on?
Man, that's a hard one. I love fitness equipment.
Yeah.
So I would say the chest-supported T-bar row is just the feeling of that. Just feels great to me. That's one of my favorite ones. A good side raise machine. So they're so hit or miss for me. Shoulders have always been a weak point, so trying to find a way to make sure my shoulders are actually activating and I'm not using my traps has always been a battle. And just the mechanics of each machine are so different, you kind of never know exactly where it's going to line up with, you know, your joints and everything. So finding a good side raise machine, I always appreciate. So I'd say a good side raise machine or T-bar row are two close ties there.
What are some of the elements of like good equipment that you found? So like, I know a cable machine pretty much hits everything. Is it the versatility or the fact that it, like for a bodybuilder, is it better for a machine to do one thing really, really well? Or is it better for a machine to be able to do, a few things like a cable machine?
I would say one thing really, really well, okay, and then just have a machine for everything. If you can. Now, obviously that's going to be limited on what gym you go to. You know, when it comes down to it, I think that's really going to come down to what that bodybuilder is weak on. If the only thing a bodybuilder is weak on is their shoulders, then having an awesome, you know, side raise machine is going to be so much more beneficial than having a cable machine. But if someone, you know, is weak on arms, a cable machine might be better because you can hit biceps, triceps, and you can use a bunch of different attachments. So I'd say that really comes down to a little bit of nuance of individuals. Personally, I just like one machine to do one thing really, really well.
Yep. Least favorite workout?
I would say, so my legs were lacking when I first started bodybuilding because I powerlifted before, and I never really directly hit hamstrings. So I had to have my own hamstring and glute day, which is just the most boring day to me. You know, just there's nothing really too exciting about a seated ham curl. RDLs you can get a little, you know, or go a little heavy and have a little fun with, but just an absolutely boring day is hamstring and glutes, if I had to say.
And from a training standpoint, because I mean, are you spending 2, 3, 4, 5 all day in the gym, or how long are your sessions normally?
So I would say they normally run about 1 hour 45, but a lot of that too is warm up. You know, throughout the workout.
How important is that, by the way?
I mean, very. In terms of just protecting your joints and your ligaments and everything and making sure you have longevity, I mean, that's obviously there. But in terms of actually making sure the muscle group you're trying to use is firing, you know, a good example is this. Everyone knows if you come in to do a max bench and you're going for 315, if you just come in right out of your car, walk up to the bench for 315 on the bar, it's going to feel so freaking heavy. Like, it's going to crush you, even if you can physically do it. But having those warm-ups to make sure that central nervous system is adapting to the weight. So even besides, you know, just in terms of making sure that your ligaments and joints are healthy and warm, there is something to be said about doing proper warm-ups just to make sure you're able to handle the weight and that muscle group is firing that you want to fire.
So are you doing like rolling and band work and all that stuff? Or when you say warm up, are you talking about like doing sets of the actual exercise before you get into it?
Yeah, so that's something I've actually changed as I've gotten better at bodybuilding. I used to do a lot of warm ups on the actual exercise itself. So, you know, a lot of people do this. They'll do sets of 16 till they can do sets of 12, and then they'll do sets of 12 till they can do sets of 8, and then they just finish off with like a heavy set of 6. What I found is a lot of times those warm ups, even if they're not to failure, are taking away from how much weight and how many reps you can get for that set of 6. Yeah. So maybe if you warmed up less in terms of pre-exhausting the muscle, that set of 6 could have been a set of 10. Okay. You know, and that's going to attribute to more muscle mass. So I found actually that it's been a little bit better for me to warm up a lot more with bands, body weight, and make sure the joints are warm from there. And then when I approach the movement, hitting less reps, but just making sure the central nervous system's firing. So more so warming up with the movement is to be able to handle the weight, like I was talking about on the bench. Right. You know, doing, not just jumping from, you know, the bar to 3 plates, doing, you know, a quarter, plate and a quarter, all the way up, but not necessarily doing a ton of sets, because if you've already warmed up from, you know, bodyweight push-ups, some band work, some mobility work, you should be able to, you know, safely do the movement. And then one other thing in terms of bodybuilding that's a little bit different from most other strength sports like powerlifting or Olympic lifting is there's not a huge benefit in going below 6 reps in terms of hypertrophy.
Oh, okay.
So as long as you don't let your ego get in the way and you just stick within like that 6 to 12 rep range, it's very difficult to get hurt when you're doing a set of 8 rather than when you're doing like a triple or a double.
Well, yeah, powerlifters are notoriously, well, I say injury prone. It really depends on where you're coming from. But, yeah, ego definitely plays a factor. So what's your next show coming up?
So I'm not sure yet. I actually have my first baby with my fiance coming in August. So until we figure out how that rolls, you know, I want to make sure I'm in a good rhythm with taking care of him before I actually prep for another show. And then also going into a pro debut, those guys are just so much bigger. I mean, going to be against Chris Bumstead potentially on stage. Like, you know, those guys. So I don't want to rush into it. I'll probably wait a year, year and a half, potentially 2 years, depending. So I don't really have any plans. In the meantime, it's just try to put on the size to match those guys.
And where can people find you if they want to learn more about you? Do you have any coaching programs or anything like that? Or
yeah, so I do coach both lifestyle and bodybuilding. So, you know, a lot of times it's not quite as strict with the lifestyle, but on Instagram it's Thomas Bodytech _IFBB Pro.
Okay, awesome.
And what kind of training and that kind of? You said lifestyle and what was the other thing?
Bodybuilding, like competitive bodybuilding.
Okay, awesome. Well, I really appreciate you coming by and doing the podcast, man.
Yeah, man. It's great talking to you.
This was super informative. I think talking to you has really helped not only our listeners, but also me understand like the technical aspects of bodybuilding a lot more and how much goes into it. I think people think, because they see powerlifting a lot, right? And you just go in, you do your sets, and you're done. Like, bodybuilding is a lifestyle. It's not just, you know, go in, get the work, and you're done for the day.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like it's that with almost every sport. Like, there's so much technical aspects behind anything you really look into. Like, you know, even with powerlifting, those guys have charted out their RPEs, you know, their percentages. And to the casual viewer, they're just coming in and lifting heavy. No, they very well could be intentionally doing a set of 3 this day or a top set of 1. Same thing with bodybuilding. Like I said, when you asked what would surprise people, it's the consistency of how much goes in outside of the gym. So, yeah, like with anything, there's always more behind the scenes.
Well, check them out. Thomas Allen. And then if you guys are in the area in Huntersville, Olympus Gym. This is a great facility. And one thing that we were talking about a little bit before is the owners will actually take a poll. So guys like Thomas can actually submit their votes for the type of fitness equipment or pieces that they'd like to see in the gym, and they'll actually buy them. So that's a really cool aspect to the gym. So, yeah. Well, thank you for coming by, man.
Oh, yeah,
I really
appreciate
it. Awesome.
Good to see you.
Thank you for listening. Please give FreedomCast a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to podcasts. It would mean a lot to our business. Plus, it's fun to read y'all's reviews. See you next time.